welcome again. Thank you very much for coming on. This evening we're going to discuss the whole issue of what are transition studies. A lot of people have been writing in and asking about the website transition studies, and in fact asking, what is this transition studies? Is it a new form of academic research? Is it a new area that they feel they have to get in touch with? Is it a new burden for graduate students? Is it a new field that everyone now has to reorient themselves to? Well, actually not. It's a new orientation towards all of those fields that are out there. And that's what we want to look at a bit. That is, the way in which transition studies are now kind of encapsulating and providing an umbrella under which a lot of other things are taking place and need to take place if we wish to be part of the global ecosystem for very much longer. We're set on trajectories that are not sustainable. It's not just any one culture or any one society, but the entire human enterprise is crashing beyond the limits of its life support system. If we wish to persist as a member of the global species community, we're going to have to learn how to make the transition towards sustainability, away from continuous growth paradigms, which have been driving us in the past. So what we're going to be looking at today is a little bit of the dimensions of what's involved in transition studies, looking at steps toward a just and sustainable future. It's not self-evident, but it has been pointed out for a long time that we're on unsustainable trajectories. At the UN, this case was made not too long ago, and the question was posed, why transition studies? Why undertake it at all? Well, the case was made rather succinctly in a few words. Let's go look at it, because it's a powerful enough statement in a small enough context, that is to say, they managed to get the statement out in a few words. We're a fossil fuel dependent civilization, independent of what nationality we are. Our modern civilization is dependent on fossil fuels. We have to get to being a solar sustainable system. You'll admit, there's a bit of a transition. And it's that transition that's the key. Transition is the key to, in effect, the movement from where we are to where we need to be. That's what was put out in front of the delegates there at the UN, and it was then discussed in several venues for days after that. But again, it's not new. Sir David Attenborough has been pointing this out for years, especially drawing attention to the impact of human societies upon all other life forms on Earth. He's perhaps the world's most famous naturalist, and he's reflected on the transitions that have taken place with wild species on Earth because of the human presence. As he's put it, it's pretty dramatic. Take a look.
They've been polluted and increasingly acidified, and the Earth is warming. We now realize that the disasters that continue increasingly to afflict the natural world have one element that connects them all: the unprecedented increase in the number of human beings on the planet. There have been prophets who've warned us of this impending disaster, of course. One of the first was Thomas Malthus. His most important book, An Essay of the Principle of Population, was published over 200 years ago in 1798. In it, he argued that the human population would increase inexorably until it was halted by what he called misery and vice. Today, for some reason, that prophecy seems to be largely ignored, or at any rate disregarded. It's true that he did not foresee the so-called Green Revolution, which greatly increased the amount of food that can be produced in any given area of arable land. And there may be other advances in our food producing skills that we ourselves still can't foresee. But such advances only delay things. The fundamental truth that Malthus proclaimed remains the truth. There cannot be more people on this earth than can be fed.
Well, that's a very succinct way of putting it as well. Can't be more people on this earth than can be fed. Obvious. It's a primary rule of biology. No organism can outlive its life support system. So you have to pay attention to the organisms and the population and their life support system. If they're exceeding their life support system, they're about to crash. This is a biological universal. It's not just the idea of Malthus. He's applying it, in a sense, to the human population. And as David Attenborough has pointed out, it's been largely ignored ever since. But we ignore that to our peril because, in fact, it's still operative, as he points out. This has not gone away. In fact, as he points out, the Green Revolution did not solve the food problem for human beings. On the contrary, it merely postponed it and amplified it. And this is really a very sobering insight that he brings to our attention once again. Take a look. He suggested, for example, that economists haven't gotten the point.
Many people would like to deny that this is so. They would like to believe in that oxymoron, sustainable growth. Kenneth Boulding, President Kennedy's environmental advisor 45 years ago, said something about this. Anyone who believes in indefinite growth in anything physical on a physically finite planet, he said, is either mad or an economist.
Either mad or an economist. Now, that's in effect the problem we're up against, because large parts of public policy, both within this country and around the world, have been advised by, and in effect directed toward, the economics of continuous growth. It's not possible in an ecosystem, but every single government in the post-World War II period has focused itself on the growth paradigm as its reason for existence, and in fact, every candidate presenting themselves in elective democracies or in dictatorships, selecting themselves, have been arguing that they can make the system grow faster than their competitor. They haven't abandoned the growth paradigm. In fact, they've embraced it. And this is what Sir David Attenborough pointed out in this last speech before the Royal Society of England, the oldest scientific organization in the English-speaking world, and the one at which the Duke of Edinburgh presided for his very last time as president of the Royal Society. A sobering awareness, especially since by listening to the economists that are focused on certain kinds of growth, we get a very unsettling, in fact disturbing report on what the nature of that growth has led to. Take a look at the recent Research Institute's report from the World Bank on global wealth in 2015. They point out that 1% of the world's population controls more than 50% of the total global wealth. This is hardly a growth in the overall welfare of humankind. It's the growth in the welfare of certain portions of the human enterprise. Take a look. It's staggering.
A new report by Credit Suisse says the wealthiest 1% of the world.
The wealthiest 1% of the world's population, she's about to say, even if the computer connection isn't very good here. Let's see if we can retrieve it.
The world's population now controls 50% of total global wealth. This is the most extreme concentration of wealth the bank has ever recorded. In contrast, the report shows average household wealth has fallen 17% in Latin America and 12% in Europe amidst austerity programs.
Okay. Well, that's pretty simple to figure out. That is, the average wealth has fallen per household, but the concentration of wealth has increased and, in fact, been very dramatically concentrated at
Inequality across the globe has reached shocking extremes. A new report shows the combined wealth of the richest 1% now overtakes the rest of the world's population. According to the international aid group Oxfam, 62 rich people own as much wealth as the poorest half of the world. The figure has fallen from 388 in just over 5 years. The Anti-Poverty Agency has published its findings on the eve of the World Economic Forum in the Swiss town of Davos. The report, entitled An Economy for the 1%, says the gap between the richest and the rest has widened dramatically in the past 12 months. It also points to gender inequality, saying women are disproportionately affected by the current trend. More than 40 heads of state and government representatives are expected at the Davos meeting beginning on Tuesday. Oxfam Executive Director Winnie Byanyima says the world leaders have failed to tackle inequality despite repeated pledges. To discuss that further, we're now joined Ms. Gloria Lariva, who is with the Answer Coalition, and she's joining us live now via Skype from San Francisco. Thanks very much for joining us here on Press TV. What do you think is behind this growing inequality?
In one word, it's capitalism that is causing year by year, month by month, a growing gap between the rich, the super, super rich, and the rest of the world. As you stated, 62 people own more than the whole rest of the world. And in the United States, that figure is less than 0.2% of the population owns as much as has hardly any wealth at all. It's not even visible on the graph. And the top 1% owns what 80% of the population owns. It's obscene, and it's simply because of neoliberal policies and sanctions against countries that do not follow that neoliberal model.
Well, you can see the discussion of it here. In a European news program, calls up an American economist to give some perspective on this. And it's, in fact, discussed again and again in American news media as well. Take a look.
5 years ago, the combined wealth of the globe's top 388 billionaires was equal to half the world's population. If that contrast is shocking, consider how many billionaires it takes for that same divide today. 62. According to a new report from Oxfam on global inequality, it's now just 62 of the world's richest billionaires who own as much wealth as half the world's population. The wealth of the poorest half, that's 3.6 billion people, has fallen by $1 trillion since 2010. At the same time, the wealth of the world's richest 62 people has increased by more than half a trillion dollars. Oxfam faults a global financial system that has, quote, supercharged the age-old ability of the rich and powerful to use their position to further concentrate their wealth.
The report singles out deregulation, privatization, offshore tax havens that have let trillions of dollars go untaxed. Oxfam says denying governments of this massive source of revenue has hampered efforts to provide basic social services and tackle inequality. A review of some 200 major companies shows 90% operate in at least one tax haven. The Oxfam report is timed to coincide with the meeting of the global elites at the World Economic Forum in Davos, Switzerland. For more, we turn to Raymond Oppenheiser, president of Oxfam America. So give us these figures. 62 of the world's wealthiest people have more wealth than half the world's population. 62 individuals.
That's correct. And as you noted, that this has been an accelerating pattern. I think what our report's trying to do is really point out the fact that I think we have a global inequality crisis, and we're trying to legitimize that narrative and through the use of these kinds of numbers. I think what's been stunning to us is not only the fact that we have, you know, that level of concentration, but the process is accelerating. And I think what we're trying to understand is if we allow this process to accelerate, not only here in the United States, but literally in countries around the world and in regions where you're not expected, in the Chinas and the Indias and even in Africa, it raises a lot of questions about some of the things you talked about in your earlier broadcast about Michigan, which is how do we fund public services for the poor? How do we finance development into the future? How do we alleviate poverty if, in fact, we're seeing underfinancing of infrastructure and schools and health systems and so forth? So we're really trying to underline the fact that there is an inequality price crisis, and we've got to really address directly this accelerating concentration of wealth and the mechanisms and systems really that enable it.
Okay. Well, that's pretty clear. It's the mechanisms and systems devised by these growth-oriented economists, employed by governments and corporations seeking to maximize their wealth and improve, the governments think, their gross national product, that has led to this accelerated divide in income between the haves and the have-nots, not just in this country, but around the world. It's an absolutely shocking distribution, and it's accelerating. They contrasted what happened back just 20 years ago compared to now, and how many fewer billionaires own how much more of the world's assets. This is part of the problem that has to be taken into account in transition studies. If we're going to transition towards a more sustainable system, it has to do with putting in place economic procedures that don't allow for this out of control concentration of wealth in portions of the economy and among portions of the population, who then exert disproportionate control over the political process. Take a look again at the further conversation here.
Ray Offenheiser, can you explain specifically what the role of tax havens are in this quite staggering inequality that the report points to?
Well, tax havens basically is a mechanism that's been created by the financial industry and corporations to allow them to basically produce value in one location and then transfer that value that may have a high tax base or tax rate, and then transfer it in some fashion or another to another location with a much lower tax rate, and then pay the tax rate in those locations where it's much more favorable. And there's all sorts of accounting mechanisms that allow this to happen, and also legislation that provides loopholes that enable companies to move value overseas. So, for example, here in the United States, companies actually can deduct the costs of moving jobs overseas in one case. They can actually move the value of brands and trademarks overseas. They're exempt from, for example, taxing the value of subsidiaries overseas. So there's a variety of ways these tax havens, the tax rules, enable the tax havens to work.
Okay. And who writes tax rules? Congressmen who have to get reelected, and they have very expensive campaigns to get reelected. They seek support among the donors who, as it turns out, happen to be large corporations that have the freedom to express themselves because of Citizens United as citizens, so they express themselves with large donations. You can see the system. It's absolutely inoperable in the long term, but it's very functioning right now. That is to say, it's operating while we're talking as a way of concentrating the wealth in the hands of a very few at the very top. Now, people have been looking at alternatives to this for a while, and it's worth catching up with them, especially when you realize they've been seeing the process as something that's not sustainable.
The economic system is producing inequality, unemployment, ecological destruction, global warming, and putting more people in prison. That's a system that is out of control. It also seems to regularly produce more war. Doesn't much matter who's elected. It's beyond politics.
There there's the crisis of inequality, the crisis of climate, and then certainly a lack of a real democracy.
1945 to 1975 are considered the golden years of American capitalism. And from that particular point on, real wages for the average American worker have been stagnant.
The great increase in inequality has made this process very hard to change. It's made corporate motives, very short-term motives of corporate growth and the enrichment of the top 1%, effective, very hard to beat.
The policy space that we have developed to address this crisis is getting us nowhere.
People are at a dead end with traditional politics. And so either you build from the bottom up or nothing changes.
Either you build from the bottom up, according to Gar Alperovitz, or nothing changes. Either you build from the bottom up, and that's going to take millions of people. Take a look.
It's going to take millions and millions of people in motion to create the kind of system change that we need. And so we have really shifted our attention to looking at more municipal and state level strategies.
There are things that are being done everywhere around the country which, if you brought them together, add up to a mosaic that looks like a different system, building on what we know works already in this country.
And much of it has already started. This isn't a theoretical proposition alone. It started because people are looking at this question of what are transition studies. We've got to move beyond these syndromes of overshoot and collapse, where wealth is concentrated in the hands of a few. Growth is the paradigm, more, bigger, better logic, and the whole system leads to an overshoot and collapse syndrome. The obvious alternative is to stabilize the growth paradigm and to stop drawing down carrying capacity, destroying the environment, and to stabilize the production of goods and services to below the carrying capacity of the earth. Transition studies invite us to look instead of the growth paradigm, to explore new means to move beyond growth economics to achieve sustainability on a finite planet. And it's happening. Take a look.
There's a wonderful experiment in Cleveland that our group was involved with, in which a whole series of worker-owned cooperatives linked together in a community-building corporation, the Evergreen Corporation, right in the middle of one of the poorest neighborhoods.
We've started talking about and really expanding the model of community land trust, which is a strategy of taking land out of the speculative market and creating a process where community residents could actually say what they want to go onto that land.
Solar panel on everybody's roof in the neighborhood, all interconnected, that's a farmer's market in electrons. As that comes, it'll have as many interesting impacts on our way of thinking about the world as the development of fossil fuel did.
We have to set up credit unions and local banks, very local banks, where our interest payments recirculate. Urban agriculture, every individual, every neighborhood, every locality, every project, every kind of talent matter. If we approach our future through those eyes, then we begin to work at a solution.
Okay, now working at a solution is what, in effect, the bottom-up approach is starting to take. And fortunately, there are groups working on transition studies around the world.